very good morning and welcome to worship again this Sunday with our Artillery Salvation Army. It's big thanks to the friend of the Corps, Vic Meredith, for his message this week. We continue to be very grateful to our friends from other Corps and from other churches who are continuing to support us in this way. We are hopeful that it will not be too long before we can meet in person again at the hall, most likely with some level of social distancing in place. But in the meantime, we are very grateful for those who are helping us out with our message each week. One big announcement, Susan Morgan has a birthday this week. Now the newsletter says that it's a milestone birthday, so I can only assume that she's 21. So we wish Susan a very happy 21st birthday this week. Obviously, there would have been a party were it not for lockdown, so maybe we'll have to save that for another time. The other big news is that from the beginning of July, we will be having a new division in the Salvation Army that our Corps will be a part of, and along with that, a new divisional commander. Our new division will be called the Wales Division, and that brings together the division that we're currently part of, South and Mid Wales Division, together with the Welsh Corps, who are currently part of the division known as the North West England and North Wales Division. So all the Welsh Corps across the whole of Wales will be brought together into the Wales Division. And our new divisional leader will be Major Roger Batt, who is a Welshman. Huzzah! So, changes afoot, but changes that obviously our territorial leaders have made with a lot of thought and a lot of prayer. And maybe it would be good for us as well as members of the division that's going to be affected to add it to our prayer list as well, and to pray that moving forward some great things are going to happen in the New Wales Division. So our first song together is Tell Me the Story of Jesus, that lovely hymn written by Fanny Crosby. And then after that, we will have a time of prayer that will start with the song Seek Ye First.
Glory to God in the highest. of God and His Let us pray together.
Dear loving Heavenly Father, we do thank you that we can continue to meet together, even remotely like this, in order to praise your name. We may be sitting alone in our homes, watching this on a screen, but Lord, we know that we are part of a fellowship of believers that spreads not only across Abertillery Core, but across the world. Lord, forgive us for the times when we maybe allow ourselves to be filled with feelings of loneliness. It can be difficult at times such as these when we are prevented from meeting with other people. It can be difficult to retain that sense of being part of your church. So in those times, Lord, we do ask that you will come to us and that you will comfort us and you will speak those words to us that tell of your love and that tell of your care. Father God, we do thank you that the situation with regards to coronavirus certainly does seem to be getting slowly better. We thank you for the Herculean efforts to roll out the vaccine. For those of us that have already had at least one dose, we thank you that we are able to be protected in that way. Lord, we do pray for those who are unsure as to whether to have the vaccine, those that are maybe swayed by rumours and false information. And we just pray that, you know, a sense of sense will come to it all, Lord, that people will be given clear information and that people will be supported to make the best decision for them and for their lives. Lord, we thank you for the people who have continued to work behind the scenes to ensure that not just locally your church is running, but also on a wider scale. And we do pray for the staff at THQ, who undoubtedly have had a very difficult time during the pandemic, to ensure that Salvation Army churches are ticking over. And also the staff locally in our division, who will be impacted by these changes in July. Lord, we pray for our incoming DC. We pray that your spirit will truly be upon him as he leads the work here in Wales. We pray for those core who maybe will be affected more than others by the change in divisional leadership. But we ask that it will be a spark that ignites a glorious sense of moving forward as a Welsh division to make sure that your will is done in Wales and that your kingdom values are part of what we all live to. So Father God, we ask for your blessing. We ask for your love. We ask for your peace. And we ask for your divine inspiration so that everything we think, say and do will come from you. In Jesus' name we ask all of this. Amen. Amen. And now we have this week's self-denial video. And this week we are concentrating on the work that's being done in Bangladesh.
Hello and welcome to the third of our films for this year's self-denial appeal. This week I'll be talking to Richard Bradbury. Richard and his wife Heidi have been serving in Bangladesh for the last 2.5 years. They're there with their two children and they work at the headquarters in Dhaka, the country's capital. Bangladesh has about 100 officers and about 1,000 soldiers. The country's population is increasing, especially in the cities. Dhaka has twice the population of London but is 5 times more densely populated. These images were filmed by a team from the Canada and Bermuda Territory for their self-denial appeal last year. When I caught up with Richard, he was not in Bangladesh, but quarantining in Denmark, which is Heidi's homeland, as the family took a well-earned Christmas break. Well, it's really great to be chatting with you, Richard. Can you just tell us what's it been like for you in Bangladesh?
like many places, it's been a very challenging time. It wasn't just a healthcare issue, it was more an economic issue. So many people are on daily wages. And so to not have any income during that time had some really serious implications. And when you live in very crowded conditions, whether it be in, you know, a house that you're sharing with your extended family, or when you're living on top of each other in a slum area, then transmission is much, much quicker and it's much harder to isolate things.
There was a post you made about seeing some of your international colleagues flying out. Literally, you could see their planes going over where you lived. Yeah. And you could almost just see that could have been you, but you stayed with the people. How difficult was that decision to stay?
In some ways, it was not very difficult. I think for us, we felt, well, actually, you know, we have this tremendous privilege of living in another culture. Mm-hmm. And we can't only do that during the good times. Yeah. That actually, if we are truly believing that this is our calling, this is where we are supposed to be, then that has to be during the challenging times as well. We can't just take the good bits. So yes, there were struggles in our minds, particularly at the start around the lack of the healthcare, and that was a risk, there's no doubt about it. And that's why many people went. But for us, I guess at that point, we just had to believe that our faith was stronger than our fears at that point. And we just wanted to stay and journey along with our colleagues.
How is church life continuing in Bangladesh?
During the initial lockdown stages, we had to, like many places around the world, we had to close the churches, but we don't have the benefit of Zoom or Skype or these issues. Many, you know, it's often said that places like Bangladesh, the Salvation Army is not for the poor. The Salvation Army is also the poor, you know. So many of our soldiers live in poverty, but our officers did a remarkable job just keeping everybody connected, and that was how we kept going until we were able to gather together as a church.
Yeah. Perhaps in the last few years, but certainly this year, I guess people have been thinking about what is resilience. Is that what you're saying? Is that something you've really seen in the officers and Salvationists in Bangladesh?
The Bangladeshi people are tremendously resilient, and the officers reflect that in their responses. And so we weren't just dealing with the response for COVID. We have dengue fever. We had a response for cyclone where we were helping people to rebuild their houses. They'd lost their house completely. A number of our halls and quarters were literally just blown away at the same time as we were trying to deal with the fallout from COVID as well.
Yeah.
It was the locals that really stepped up in the response. So we were able to coordinate things, but actually the majority of the work was done by the local officers, the Salvation Army officers on the ground. And they did an amazing job. You know, they went out often without concern for their own safety and did all kinds of things. And then we also have a number of clinics. And we were able to keep those open. I pay real tribute to the staff of those clinics that just kept soldiering on.
Yeah.
And I mean, another thing that I would say is that actually during this time, we've also had our self-denial appeal as well. And I'm always keen to stress that the International Salvation Army self-denial appeal is one that everybody gets to contribute in. And okay, we get more from that whole pot, but we still have the privilege of being part of that. And for many people here, it's a real act of self-denial. So that also emphasizes this idea that, you know, we stand together as Salvationists and Christians in solidarity and, you know, this togetherness and connectedness that we have.
Well, if you can send the Salvationists of Bangladesh just our love and our admiration and acknowledgement of our brotherhood and sisterhood with them.
Thank you. And we are also grateful for the support that's been given to us, the financial support, yes, but also, you know, the compassionate support and the concern that's been given to us as well.
Thanks, Richard. Yes. Speak to you another time.
Yeah.
Next week, I'll be talking to Melinda Boone in the Philippines.
It's very good to see, isn't it, the work that the army is doing around the world, and to be able to see also when we contribute to the self-denial appeal, to see where that money is going, and how in some small way we are helping the work that's being done in lovely sunny countries when we look out the wind and the rain. But we thank God that we are part of that family of his believers that have chosen to worship under the banner of the Salvation Army. Our other brothers and sisters worship in other churches, don't they? But we've chosen this way of worship, and we thank God that the vision of William Booth right from the start was to be a very practical form of Christianity, not just to talk the talk, but to walk the walk as well. So we thank God that we were able to be part of that. We are now going to listen to the song You Can't Stop God From Loving You, and it's being sung by Bristol Eastern Songsters together with the International Staff Songsters. And then we will hear this Sunday's message from our friend Vic Meredith. We will then sing together our closing song. Now, it's officially called, according to the opening slide, We Wonder Why Christ Came Into the World. But I think we kind of know it as He Came to Give His Life in All Its Fullness. So that will be our closing song. And then we will end with a lovely sung benediction. So I'm sure we are really anticipating a blessing now from hearing Vic's message to us after listening to the songsters and their presentation of You Can't Stop God From Loving You. God bless.
Sure returning, oh, the progress of good to be with you once again. Last Wednesday was Ash Wednesday, the first day of Lent, which is the six-week period of reflection and preparation before the celebrations of Easter. Lent is traditionally described as lasting for 40 days, in commemoration of the 40 days that Jesus spent fasting in the desert before beginning his public ministry. And it was during this time in the desert that he endured temptations by Satan. Our Gospel reading for today, the first Sunday of Lent, is from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 4, verses 1 to 11. Then the Spirit led Jesus into the desert to be tempted by the devil. After spending 40 days and nights without food, Jesus was hungry. The devil came to him and said, "If you are God's son, order these stones to turn into bread." But Jesus answered, "The scripture says human beings cannot live on bread alone, but need every word that God speaks." Then the devil took Jesus to Jerusalem, the holy city, set him on the highest point of the temple, and said to him, "If you are God's son, throw yourself down, for the scripture says, God will give orders to his angels about you. They will hold you up with their hands, so that not even your feet will be hurt on the stones." Jesus answered, "But the scripture also says, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Then the devil took Jesus to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in all their greatness. "All this I will give you," the devil said, "if you kneel down and worship me." Then Jesus answered, "Go away, Satan. The scripture says, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Then the devil left Jesus, and angels came and helped him. We all know what temptation is, don't we? It's when you catch yourself reaching out for that third chocolate, or when those shoes are 20% off, so they're a real bargain. Or when you see an easy way to make life uncomfortable for someone you don't like. Life is full of such moments. Sometimes we resist, sometimes we don't. But we all know that feeling, don't we? Today we think about what are commonly referred to as the temptations of Jesus. But perhaps we should find a different term for what happens to Jesus in the wilderness. The story we have heard today is about something far more serious than whether we eat another chocolate. It's about nothing less than the salvation of the world. Jesus faces the most massive test possible. He is asked to prove that he is up to the task that he has been born for. So perhaps we need to call this Jesus' training for ministry. Or perhaps it is like the severe trials that the machinery goes through in the manufacturing process, where it is tested almost to destruction to make sure it will not fail. What happens to Jesus is far removed from our own everyday experience. He has just been baptized in the River Jordan, and God's Spirit has descended on him. He is ready to take up his mission. But what kind of mission will it be? What happens in the wilderness tries out the options and sets the agenda for the task that lies ahead. In the process, it tests Jesus almost to destruction, perhaps a preparation for an even harder test to come. Let's look at what happens. The first test is whether Jesus will make bread from the stones lying around in the desert. We are told he has been fasting for 40 days, and so he is hungry. But this is not about whether he will make himself some food. This is about whether he will take on the role of God himself. When the people of Israel were travelling through the wilderness centuries before, it was God who provided them with bread, the miraculous manna, which kept him alive. Excuse me. Jesus will have heard the story before, told over and over again. He knows that the creation of miraculous food is a sign of God's presence. He knows he has God's special blessing. He believes he can make bread from stones. What a way that would be to gain a following. How wonderful to be able to give people free food. He knows how hard survival can be for people amongst whom he has grown up. He could be a benevolent saviour. What could be wrong with that? But Jesus knows that it is wrong. It isn't physical food that he has to give. It is not bread alone that matters, in his conclusion. The word of God matters too. Making bread is a distraction. Then Jesus imagines himself on the top of the temple in Jerusalem. It is the place that embodies the very essence of his faith. It is where religious power is concentrated. Perhaps he suspects that his mission will bring him into conflict with the rulers of the Jewish faith. He could show them, he thinks. If he jumps off, it is inconceivable that his heavenly Father will not save him. He could float down, landing triumphantly in the courtyard, marching into the Holy of Holies, showing his divine authority. He could take over leadership of the faith, spread it throughout the world. It's another noble cause, another cause that is wrong. His mission is not about stunts. It is much slower, more earthbound, less dramatic. It is about changing people's hearts, not dazzling them with magic. And finally, why not become an emperor? The Roman emperors have shown themselves to be far from perfect. Jesus would do the job so much better. Never mind the hard, slow job he suspects is ahead of him. The Jews have been promised a Messiah, an anointed one, and a king like David. But Jesus could be so much more. He could rule the world as a benevolent dictator, causing righteousness and justice to flourish everywhere. Yet he knows better. He knows that power corrupts and worldly kingship is not the way for him. Jesus has passed the test. He is ready for his ministry. It will be hard and more challenges will come. But Jesus' ministry is firmly set on the right foundations. Jesus refuses to make bread. But later he takes the loaves offered by a small boy and turns them into a feast for thousands. And later still, he takes a loaf, breaks it and says, "This is my body." The gift of bread comes more slowly and at a much higher cost. Jesus refuses to throw himself off the temple and be rescued. But later he makes his presence felt in the temple, clearing out those who cheat the poor and causing his own arrest. And when he needs rescue, he only finds it on the other side of death. Jesus refuses to be king. But later he rides humbly into Jerusalem on a donkey and is proclaimed king by his people. His throne turns out to be a cross, and his crown is made of thorns, and his final kingdom encompasses not just the nations of the world, but the whole of created universe. Fortunately for us, Jesus passes the test. He refuses to take the easy road to success. He turns away from drama and demonstrations. Our salvation is won not by a magician, but by a saviour who knows what it is to be human from birth to death, and who knows what it is to be hungry, who knows what it is to want admiration and power, and how to say no to all of them. Because he passed the test, it is all right that we so often fail. For us, there is bread that is his body. There is rescue at our final test of death, and there is a place in a kingdom, for the ultimate test has already been passed for us by Jesus himself. Amen.
His face and know His grace. May His peace abound to you.
Time.